Hello dear students, welcome to the fourth lecture of the unit 5 on multiplexing and multiple accesses. In the last lecture we discussed about the different time division multiplexing techniques, and in this lecture we are going to discuss about the spread spectrum, which is of two types: frequency hopping spread spectrum and direct sequence spread spectrum. The spread spectrum, in the spread spectrum we combine signals from different sources to fit into a larger bandwidth, but in this the goal is to prevent EVs dropping and jamming. To achieve these goals, spread spectrum techniques add redundancy. So in the spread spectrum, the bandwidth of the input signal is increased from B to BSS, and the process of increasing this bandwidth of the input signal is called spreading process. So the bandwidth allocated to each station need to be larger than what is needed, so this allows for the redundancy. The expanding of the original bandwidth B to the bandwidth BSS must be done by a process that is independent of the original signal. So this particular process is independent of whatever this particular signal is. The first technique, frequency hopping spread spectrum, is like this. It may have m different carrier frequencies that are modulated by the source signal. At one moment the signal modulates one carrier frequency, and at the next moment the signal modulates another carrier frequency. So the signal does not use same carrier frequency for the purpose of modulation. So we can see here that this is the signal, and here the process of modulation is done at the modulator. Then there is a frequency synthesizer, and the output signal which is modulated, and this output signal is not modulated by a single frequency, but that particular frequency changes. So there is a pseudo random code generator which selects one of the carrier frequency from this particular frequency table, and the frequency synthesizer generates the carrier frequency of that selected frequency. So for example, you can see here that we have selected M to be 8, and K, which is the bit pattern, becomes 3, and this pseudo random generator will generate 8 different patterns, 3 bit patterns. These are the 8 different patterns, and these patterns may be in any sequence, as the name suggests, pseudo random generator. So 3-bit sequence will be generated by this, and as per this particular sequence, one of the frequency will be selected from this particular table. So the table, this particular pattern says that the first pattern is 101, so the frequency to be, carrier frequency to be selected is 700 kilohertz. So this is the first hop frequency. Then so this will, the signal will be modulated for some time using this particular frequency. Then at the next time, the signal will be modulated with the frequency that is 900 kilohertz. You can see here that the next pattern is 111, so this 900 kilohertz frequency will be selected, and the input signal will be modulated using the carrier frequency 900 kilohertz, and so on like this. So the input signal, that is modulating signal, will not be always modulated with a single carrier frequency, but it will be modulated with these different carrier frequencies. So the bandwidth, if it is modulated with the single carrier frequency, would be less, would be much less than the signal which is generated here. Now the bandwidth would be something from 200 kilohertz to 900 kilohertz. So there is increase in the bandwidth that is required for the modulating of the input signal. So here we can see that for the first time slot, it is modulated using 700 kilohertz. Then in the second time slot, the signal is modulated using 900 kilohertz. In the third one, it is modulated with 300, then 200 kilohertz, after that 400 kilohertz, 800 kilohertz, 500 kilohertz, and 600 kilohertz. So after one cycle is over, again the signal is modulated with 700, with the carrier frequency of 700 kilohertz, and this particular cycle, this changing of the carrier frequencies continues as per the bit pattern selected by the pseudo random generator. Then here this particular diagram shows the bandwidth sharing and what happens in the, in case of the FDM and FSHS, that is frequency hopping spread spectrum. In the FDM, that is frequency division multiplexing, we can have four different signals and four different modulating signals and four different carrier frequencies. So this technique can be utilized in case of FSHS also. Here also we can have four different signals, and but every modulating signal will not use a single carrier frequency as it is being used in case of FDM. So the major difference between the FDM and frequency hopping spread spectrum in this case is that it is when the first modulating signal is using F1, then the F2 may be used by some other signal, F3 may be used by another modulating signal, and F4 may be used by still one more modulating signal. So at the same time, all the modulating signals, they are using one or the other carrier frequencies. So the the pattern in which these carrier frequencies would change will be generated by a pseudo random generator. So if the bandwidth is shared, then here you can see that the effective bandwidth that is required for the FDM and the effective bandwidth required for the frequency hopping spread spectrum, it will be same. That is, each signal would be using the full bandwidth F1 to F4, but because it is being shared by all the four signals, so in the same bandwidth all the four modulating signals are sent using FHSS. The next technique, spread spectrum technique, is the direct sequence spread spectrum. The direct sequence spread spectrum technique also expands the bandwidth of the original signal, like the FHSS. In DSSS, each bit is assigned a code of n bits called chips, where the chip rate is n times that of the data bit. Figure shows this particular concept. So this is the original signal consisting of the bit sequence, and this is the chip generator. What this modulator does, based on which particular bit sequence are coming here, so each bit is replaced with the with some group of bits that are generated by this particular chip generator, and it is sent on this particular output. So this is the example of the direct sequence spread spectrum. So for example, for this particular bit 1, the sequence sent is 1 0 1 1 0 1 1 1 0 0 0, whereas for 0 the bit sequence sent is 1 0 1 1 0 1 1 1 0 0 0, in the reverse order. Okay, so this is the actual sequence sent. Okay, whereas this is the spreading code. So for sending 1, the bits they are sent as it is, whereas for the zero, the bit sequence sent is like this. That is, 0 here, 1, then 0 0 1 0 0 0 1 1 1, like this. Okay, so this is the direct sequence spread spectrum techniques. So obviously here what happens is that when you are sending only one bit, here a group of bits are sent for that particular single bit. So this is what we have seen in this particular lecture: frequency hopping spread spectrum and direct sequence spread spectrum. In the next lecture, we are going to see the multiple accesses. This is the assignment 5. You can share this particular assignment. This is the next lecture. Run in the multiple access protocols, we shall be discussing about the random access protocols, control access protocol, and channelization protocols. You can share your responses at these emails or the groups. You can find the lecture material and this videos now onwards shall be available on the Google Classroom also. So you can find the material and the videos in the Google Classroom. So thank you very much for your attention. We shall meet in the next lecture.